Payroll journal entries are an important part of payroll. In this video, we'll learn about payroll journal entries for the regular payroll, as well as the accruals and reversals, and what payroll accountants do to record them. Basis for preparing a payroll journal entry is the payroll register. If the company is using payroll software, the journal entry may be automatically prepared and can be posted to the general ledger when the accountant approves it. If the company is using a payroll vendor, the vendor may provide the journal entry. However, the accountant must be able to understand what should be recorded and double-check the journal entry to ensure that it is indeed correct. Also, during an audit, accountants often answer questions related to the payroll entries and therefore must clearly understand why an entry was recorded and posted. For instance, auditors may ask for the payroll register for the entire year and how that register reconciles to all payroll journal entries that the payroll accountant recorded. Let's look at the example from our textbook. L&L Grain pays its employees biweekly and operates on a calendar fiscal year, which just means that the company's financial statements are prepared for the time period from January to December. Many companies have a fiscal year, which means that it begins in a month other than January and ends in a month other than December. Some companies use a fiscal year because it more adequately reflects the seasonality in their business. In our example, the payroll accountant for L&L Grain has completed the payroll register and issued checks for the January 27th, 2023 payroll. We can see gross pay of $18,050, as well as withholdings for federal income tax, Social Security, Medicare, and state income tax, as well as deductions for 401k contributions, health insurance premiums, and donations. In addition, we see the net pay and the employer's share of the taxes. This is the information we need to record the payroll journal entry. There are four steps to record the payroll journal entries. The first transaction records the payroll and all withholdings and deductions. In the first journal entry, we record the gross pay as the salaries and wage expense, which means that we debit that account. All withholdings and deductions and net pay are recorded as liabilities. In other words, a credit. So for L&L Grain, we debit salaries and wage expense for $18,050, and we credit federal income tax payable for the federal income tax withheld of $1,500. We credit Social Security tax payable for $1,084.38, Medicare tax payable for $253.61, state income tax payable for $577.60, and we credit the deductions for 401k for $750, health insurance premiums payable for $560, and United Way contributions payable for $180. Then we also record the liability for the net pay and salaries and wages payable by crediting that account for $13,144.41. As always, the total debits should equal the total credits. The second transaction reflects the actual payment of the net pay to the employees, which releases the liability that we previously recorded to salaries and wages payable. The second transaction is recorded by debiting salaries and wages payable and crediting cash for $13,144.41. The employee's share of the payroll is not the only transaction. The employer's share of the payroll taxes must be recorded as well. That is the third step. In this step, we record the entire amount of the employer's share of the taxes as a payroll tax expense, and then record each liability to the appropriate liability account. So let's look at this entry. On January 27th, we debit the payroll tax expense for $2,387.39. Credit Social Security tax payable for $1,084.38. We credit the Medicare tax payable account for $253.61. Credit the FUTA tax payable for $104.94. And we credit the SUTA tax payable account for $944.46. In addition to the first three entries, the employer is responsible for remitting all voluntary deductions, such as 401k, health insurance, and contributions. For example, that means that we debit the 401k for $750, health insurance premiums payable for $560, and United Way contributions payable for $180, and then credit the cash account for the total amount of $1,490. Many companies also match the employee's 401k contributions and pay part of the health insurance. If that is the case, these entries would debit the applicable expense account and credit the applicable liability account. And just in case you're wondering, payroll accounts often use Excel functions such as VLOOKUP or XLOOKUP and SUMIFS to link the payroll register to the journal entries to avoid having to manually type all of these numbers. Here's another example. Giblin's Goodies pays employees weekly on Fridays. The gross pay is $4,500, and it shows us the withholdings and net pay of $35,45.75. In addition, we see FUTA taxes and SUTA taxes. What do we have to do to record the payroll journal entry for this payroll and the employer's share of the payroll taxes? To record the payroll register amounts, we debit salaries and wage expense for $4,500, and we credit FIT payable for the federal income tax withheld of $520. We credit Social Security tax payable for $279, Medicare tax payable for $65.25, state income tax payable for $90, and record the liability for the net pay and salaries and wages payable by crediting that account for $3,545.75. As always, the total debit should equal the total credits. To record the employer's share of the payroll taxes, we debit the payroll tax expense for $614.25, credit the Social Security tax payable account for $279, we credit Medicare tax payable for $65.25, credit FUTA tax payable for $27, and we credit the SUTA tax payable account for $243. Now that we've learned about recording payroll journal entries, let's talk about payroll accruals and reversals. What are payroll accruals and reversals? While payroll accounts accrue for payroll expenses before closing the monthly general ledger. What does that mean? It means that we record the estimated expense for the month, even though we might not know the exact amount of the payroll yet. This is a common occurrence in payroll accounting when the end of the accounting period does not match with the payroll period. When this occurs, the payroll accountant must record the payroll that is earned but not disbursed, which is known as an accrual. This accrual appears as an adjusting entry. And a very typical practice is to mark this as a reversing entry in the accounting system. That means that the estimate is automatically reversed on the first date of the next accounting period. Why? Well, if you did not reverse it, the accountant would have to figure out the difference between the actual payroll and the estimate and book only the difference. However, then the entry doesn't tie back to the payroll register. So to avoid that, accountants auto-reverse or manually, if you're not using an accounting software, the payroll accrual. So let's look at an example. Giblin's Goodies pays employees weekly on Fridays. However, the company notices that March 31st is a Wednesday and the pay period will end on April 2nd. The payroll data for March 29th through 31st is shown in this table. Gross pay is $19,000. Federal income tax is $2,185. Social Security, $1,178. And Medicare, $275.50, as well as state income tax, $380. FUTA, $414. And SUTA, $1,026. The first step is to record the accrual for the employee's payroll. The second step is to record the employer's payroll tax entry, and then we'll record the two reversing entries on April 1st. So let's first record on March 31st the payroll accrual by debiting salaries and wage expense for $19,000, which represents the gross pay. All withholdings from the employee's paycheck and the net pay are recorded as liabilities, which we'll record by crediting federal income tax payable for the federal income tax withheld of $2,185. We credit Social Security tax payable for $1,178, Medicare tax payable for $275.50, state income tax payable for $380, and salaries and wages payable for $14,981.50, which represents the net pay. Next, we'll accrue on March 31st for the employer's share of the payroll taxes by debiting payroll tax expense for $2,593.50, the total of Social Security, Medicare, FUTA, and SUTA, and then credit the amount of the Social Security tax payable for $1,178, Medicare tax payable for $275.50, FUTA tax payable for $114, and SUTA $1,026. The entries recorded as step 3 and 4 are the exact reversals of what we previously accrued. In step 3, we're reversing the payroll accrual, and in step 4, we're reversing the employer share of the payroll taxes. If you're using an accounting software program, the system will record the reversing entries for you automatically if you mark the original entries as reversing.